10 miles north of Locksley. Brad's planning on moving against him. But when he comes up with an idea, he has a Brigadier General Cadwallader to Washburn. Leave Helena, Arkansas, by boat, and then they disembark on a cavalry raid. Now, Washburn, there's a statue of him in the park. He is the brother of Congressman Elihu Washburn. Elihu Washburn added an E on the end of his name. For some reason, I guess he wanted to disassociate himself with the rest of the family. Kind of like Isham Garrett did. The Garrett family had a break, and they added an extra T on the name. Some built, some don't. So you never know. Down in Fort Gibson, the Abraham, a Jewish family, broke apart. Half of them became Southern Baptists and called themselves Abrahams. The other half became Jewish and called themselves Abrahams. So you never know what can happen. Nothing as nasty as a family fight. So there's something going on in the Washburn family. And the answer to either thing. But Brigadier General Cadwallader to Washburn is going to lead this raid. By the way, Cadwallader to Washburn after the Civil War becomes the founder of General Mills. So when you have the pleasure of paying $4 for a box of cereal and four and selling for $35 a silo, you can thank that family. $5 for a box of cereal, right? So the Washburn family is still making money off of it. The idea is they move south from Helena, and the idea is to strike Pemberton's Railroad just north of Grenada on the Yallaloosa River where the bridges go over the river and sever his line of communication, keeping him stranded up here with his railroad cut. That's the idea. The raid fails. The Confederate cavalry will drive Washburn away before he gets to the railroad bridges that run along this railroad. However, this spooks Pemberton. It spooks him how close he came to losing his line of communication. So he falls back 50 miles to Grenada, Mississippi, and Grant moves down to Oxford. So that little raid, even though it was a failure, gained him 50 miles of southern real estate. And now Pemberton is on the Yallaloosa River, digging in just north of Grenada, Mississippi. And that will be his new line. Notice, he now has those railroad bridges in front of him. They are no concern to him anymore. They are not his Achilles heel. That's his game plan. So it's interesting what a raid, even though it fails, can accomplish. So it didn't fail. Tactically, it failed. Strategically, it was a great success. Let's take a quick look at Pemberton's new line. There's Oxford, Mississippi. This is where Pemberton is. On the 1st of December, he falls back 50 miles, and by the 7th of December, he's in Grenada, Mississippi. And Grant has gained that much territory that easily. This is one of the fortifications on the Yallaloosa line. There are two houses in Grenada that claim that they were Pemberton's headquarters. I will show you the one that is most likely to me, and this is more Galladay Hall in Grenada. Allegedly, this was General Pemberton's headquarters. There's another house down the street that claims the same thing, so when you go to Grenada, you never commit yourself. Jeff Davis will actually visit Pemberton in one of these houses. Now let's take a quick look at Grant's new line. Grant will move from Holly Springs down to Oxford, Mississippi. Colonel Brown's house that we believe they... You can't get anybody in Oxford to talk Civil War. Oxford has become the Aspen South. It's not correct, politically correct, to talk Civil War in Oxford. And if you go around in Oxford and you ask anybody where Grant's headquarters are, you who? I dug around with some of the old timers up there, and They pretty much agreed that Grant stayed in Colonel Brown's house, which is where the Lafayette County Jail is today, on Jackson Street. It used to be called Depot Street, but today it's called Jackson Street. And I went back to the diary accounts, and that will match, as we'll see in a minute. I do believe that's where it was. Sherman moves down. He's with Grant. He moves down to College Hill Church. College Hill, just about 6-7 miles to the northwest of Oxford, and he encamps there. They're there on the 4th of December, 1862. Now, here's things start happening. Grant writes, I was very much disturbed by newspaper rumors that General McClellan was to have a separate and independent command within mine. He says he learns this in December. He actually knows this in late October. His staff officers know it, which means he knows it. But he's playing dumb here because he's not supposed to know this. And but it's a secret. But McClernand has gone to Washington, D.C. John Alexander McClernand, who used to work for Grant. I used to think McClernand was a tall guy until we started looking at this photograph. Photograph of McClernand at Sharpsburg, Maryland, at Antietam. McClernand, what he's done, he's taken a leave from the Army, a leave of absence from the Army in August, and he's gone back to Illinois and he's campaigned with Governor Richard Gates, the original Tricky Dick, the governor of Illinois. And he gets with Tricky Dick and he says, you know, I believe that if I can get an independent command and I can recruit an army from Illinois, Indiana, and Ohio, I believe I can do this and I can take Vicksburg. Governor says, well, let's go to Washington. I got to go to a governor's meeting. Go with me, and I'll introduce you to the president, because I know him quite well. So he goes to Washington, and he takes the train. The president is going down to Antietam to visit General McClellan after the Battle of Antietam, and so McClellan rides the train with Abe Lincoln down to Antietam, Maryland, and gets his photograph taken with Alan Pinkert and Abe Lincoln and so forth, and then takes the train back. We don't know what was said on that train, but I would love to have been a fly on the wall of that car. You hear what we said. By the end of this, the deal has been struck. McClernand is to have an independent command, and he can recruit these troops, mass them in Memphis, and he can capture Vicksburg. General Halleck, who is a lawyer, manages to slide an escape clause in there. The escape clause is any troops not needed by General Grant. There's the escape clause. McClernand's a lawyer. He should have seen that, but he didn't. And so he thinks he's got murder. It's a confidential order, by the way. Of course, there's no such thing as a confidential order in Washington, D.C., and instantly everybody knows about it. And Grant learns about it. He claims that General Washington learns about it while he's in Mississippi. He knows a lot sooner than that. So the deal is between Lincoln and McClernand. On the 21st of October, 1862, this confidential order is cut. And McClernand can recruit his army. Grant now realizes that this is about to come to fruition. These men that McClernand has recruited, he's done it much quicker than anybody thought he could do. And by December, he's got 30,000 fresh troops in Memphis waiting to go. And everybody begins to get a little uneasy, including the guys who made the deal with him. You know, this guy's moving a little faster than we thought he could move. He's not a professional soldier. What can we do? And Halleck leaks word to Grant about this and lets him know, if you can get back to Memphis before the 20th of December, you can take those men. That's basically his way of saying McClernand is going to be here by the 20th of December. Up until then, they're yours. Once he gets here, they're his. So Grant writes on, at Oxford, desiring to have a competent commander in charge, I ordered Sherman on the 8th of December back to Memphis to take charge. So he tells Sherman, I need you to skedaddle and get up to Memphis and take command of those men. So Sherman is going to head up to Memphis. He goes down to Oxford the 8th of December, meets with Grant, and talk about this in Colonel Brown's house, which is the Lafayette County Jail today. The next morning, Sherman heads out to Memphis, Tennessee, gets to Memphis on the 13th of December. On the 20th, he's headed down the river. You can see that the mission here was not so much to capture Vicksburg as it was to beat McClernand to the punch. And they leave too quickly. As they leave out of Memphis, the commands are not properly organized, and they leave some very important equipment on the ground. They don't have a good plan, and they leave the stringers to their pontoon bridges back in Memphis, which means they can't cross the swamps. Those bladders are real fine, but if you don't have stringers to go across them, they're a real problem. Grant, the game plan is Grant is going to move south and hold Pemberton in place at Grenada. Sherman is going to go down the river and waltz in the back door in Vicksburg by himself. Sounds like a pretty good plan. If the mission is to capture Vicksburg, but the mission is to beat McClernand to the punch, and then moving out at the worst time of the year with an untrained army with brand new commanders, and they don't have a good game plan. Politics are strange bedfellows here. Now, while Grant is in Oxford, he's going to have a major distraction come his way. This is sort of obscure, but I get asked this question every now and then, so I'll point it out to you. There's a colonel named Colonel Dubois,
an obscure character, a West Point officer from New York State.
Grant has put him in command at Holly Springs. Now, keep in mind, Holly Springs is a rear echelon supply depot. That's not a good combat command. That's not how you get your ticket punched. It's not a green tab command. You're in the rear shipping beans and bullets up front to the guys who do the fighting. Nobody wants that command if you're looking to punch your ticket as a combat commander. But the problem about Dubois is, Dubois has been on the staff of Henry Wedger Halleck. He was his artillery officer. And he was on Halleck's staff when Halleck came down on Grant. So, he is guilty by association. He was also on Rosecrans' staff. Go back and take a look. He was also on Rosecrans' staff. Now, Grant and Rosecrans, as we saw last week, have had a falling out. As Rosecrans is spreading rumors back in the fall of months in October, November, that Grant was drinking. So anybody that's been associated with Halleck and Rosecrans is not exactly on Grant's A list. And I think that's, Grant never says this. He doesn't even mention Dubois. But Dubois is back in Holly Springs, pulling up the rear. He's riding the bench while the other players are on the field. Dubois gets up. Dubois is a guy, he's a very observant man. He wrote some interesting memoirs that I was able to get a copy of from the Missouri Historical Society. Rosecrans made him burn some of his memoirs, but what he does have left, he drops off at Shallow. But what he has to say about people is very truthful, but you shouldn't put it on paper, because if somebody else reads it, you get in trouble. Dubois, on the 8th of December, 1862, writes, "All cotton speculators, Jews, and other vagrants will leave in 24 hours, and they will be sent to duty in the trenches." He is fed up with these cotton speculators who are following the army. Remember, cotton has been declared a material of war. It's selling for $1 a pound in 1862. That's $425 a bale. Cotton today sells for 75 cents a pound. So if you take $1 a pound in 62, that would make it worth about $25 to $30 a pound today in today's currency. It's a very valuable commodity. And it's been declared a material of war, so the federal army is confiscating it everywhere they go. Now the Navy has a prize act, which means if they confiscate cotton, the ship's captain and the crew get to split 55% of the money of that cotton amongst themselves. The prize act. So that's fine, but the army has no such thing. And what's happening is the cotton speculators, the civilians are coming down wanting to buy this cotton that the army's confiscating, and they're telling the commanders, "We're slipping some money under the table if you give us your cotton," and it's leading to the corruption of the officer corps. And Grant and Sherman are furious about this because their officers are on the take, and they're actually bidding against each other for who gets the cotton. And they're very furious about this. And this gets to Dubois, and one of the problems is a huge majority of these cotton speculators are Jewish, and Dubois writes this order and banishes them out and says, "Well, they'll be sent to the trenches." This happens on the 8th of December, 1862. When Grant gets word of this down in Oxford, he blows a stack. He says, "Permission has been granted to cotton speculators. Any order you publish different will have to be rescinded," and he relieves Dubois. Relieves him. And brings in another guy who is a bench warmer named Robert C. Murphy. All right, let's see what happens just a few days later. Grant is down in Oxford. He's relieved of why he's brought in Robert C. Murphy. If you remember from last week, Robert C. Murphy was the commander in Iuka who let the Confederates capture all of those freight train cars full of hospital supplies. And Rosecrans wanted to court-martial Murphy for this, but Grant covered for him, probably because he was just trying to thumb Rosecrans, give him not thumb, but a finger. Because by this time, they're not happy with each other. So he covers for Murphy, and he puts Murphy in charge of Holly Springs. Then showing up in Holly Springs is Jesse Root Grant, Grant's daddy. 15 December 1862. Jesse Root Grant is a corrupt human being. He absolutely loves the dollar to the nth degree.
When Brett would write letters to his dad and tell him confidential information, Jesse would sell them to the papers. And it would show up in the newspapers, and Grant learned not to tell his daddy anything in writing. Now Jesse Root Grant shows up in Holly Springs with two cotton speculators that he has introduced to the folks in Washington. They have given them a special permit, the Mack brothers, two Jewish guys, the Mack brothers, and they've got a deal that Jesse Root is going to give them the cotton, and he gets 25% of the take for just sitting around while they do the work. And word of this gets to Grant. Not only does this infuriate him, it embarrasses him to the nth degree that his daddy is doing this. Nobody can make you madder than a family member. And this is his dad. He's shown up now. He's just run off a colonel for showing his fanny, and now his dad comes up and runs around town naked, basically. So, all over the cotton, Grant in a fit of anger, and Grant is usually a very phlegmatic man, calm nature. In a fit of anger, he writes this order, General Order Number 12. He writes it in Oxford. The popular word is he wrote it in Holly Springs. No, he was in Oxford. The Jews of the class violating every regulation of trade established are hereby expelled from the department within 24 hours. Blows his stack and banishes all the Jews from his department. Well, this doesn't go well. When this hits Washington, guess what happens? The B'nai B'rith, the Jewish members of Congress, everybody goes to see the president. They go raising all kinds of cane. These are some of the documents out of the Library of Congress protesting all of this to His Excellency Abraham Lincoln. All of this is going. This is a special proclamation by Jewish organizations condemning all of this. And Halleck sent a message to Grant, if such an order has been issued, it will be immediately revoked. And Congress is actually thinking about passing a resolution against Grant. They don't do it. It's actually moved to do this. Julia Grant writes in her diary, Grant wrote that obnoxious order expelling Jews from his lines. The general said he had no right to make an order against any special sect. She acknowledges and he acknowledges that he lost his temper. I'm telling you why I think he lost his temper. You can read all these other accounts and people try to go, what made him do this? What made him do something so out of character? Actually, just relieved the man from doing the same thing? His daddy did it. There's no doubt in my military mind. But it is a major training distractor. In the midst of all of this, here comes his daddy pulling this kind of stuff. Now, here's another little problem. On the 3rd of December, Julia Grant shows up in Holly Springs. That was the question last week. Where was Julia Grant? Most of your books have it wrong because folklore is so strong. And the folklore has Julia Grant in Holly Springs during the Van Dorn raid, and it shows up. I'm still working on a couple of friends of mine to get their books corrected on this. She was not, he was in Holly Springs. She stayed in the Walter place, arrives on the 3rd of December, 1862. She brings with her 4-year-old son, Jesse, and she has also with her a slave, one of her slave maids. Julia owned 3 slaves. She was from Missouri, which was not affected by the Missouri Compromise. Also. From the range we went to Holly Springs, to find this out, you've got to go to Julia Grant's battle. And then you can also go and find out from one of the reporters, and also from Grant's chief of staff's wife. Mrs. Hillier also had a diary that I was able to get a copy of. Believe it or not, it was in Costa Rica. I don't know why it was down there, but it ended up down there. And John Simon got me a page out of it, but John's gone down there. So we were able to confirm all of this. So as soon as the road, that means the railroad, was finished, we would go to Oxford and come down the same, but the railroad's not finished, it's been torn up, and she shows up in Holly Springs. Now, on the 5th of December, General Pemberton gets a proposal from Lieutenant Colonel John Griffith, a Texan. And Griffith is unhappy that the cavalry, which he is, he's a cavalryman, that they're scattered all over God's green acres, and they're not really, they're just wandering around with no real mission. And his proposal is this. If you will set up a cavalry expedition comprising of 3,000 or 4,000 men, they get 3,500, and give us Major General Earl Van Dorn. This is a guy that Pemberton replaced, who was relieved.
Van Dorn.
Then who no braver man lives, and you can't argue, he may not have been the smartest, but he sure was brave. No doubt about it. He actually went up against Bedford Forrest. They were almost getting ready to get in a sword fight. And Van Dorn's about half as tall as Forrest. He says, we will penetrate the rear of the enemy, capture Hot Springs, and perhaps force him to retreat. Now, Van Dorn was the commander at the Battle of Pea Ridge. He managed to snatch defeat from the jaws of victory at Pea Ridge, Arkansas, back in March of 1862, by just pushing his men too far, too fast against Samuel Curtis. And we saw last week how he got ripped at Corinth, Mississippi, by still doing the same thing, pushing his troops too far, too fast, and then not closing the deal because his men were so worn out at the Battle of Corinth. This is Van Dorn against Rosecrans. So he's been relieved of command, if you recall from last week, and Perman has been placed in command on the 15th of October, 1862. So they give Van Dorn, they put him back in his niche. His niche is a cavalryman, and that's where he was born and raised. And now they put him back, and they cut a secret order, it was so secret we don't even have a copy of it, and give him a cavalry division that's cut on the 12th of December, 1862. This cavalry division, one of the brigades is going to be commanded by Colonel Robert McCulloch. He's going to be Missourians and Mississippians. The other brigade is going to be commanded by Colonel Griffith. These are going to be Texans, 1,500 of them. And this is the mystery brigade. We still don't have a real true record of exactly which Tennessee regiments are in this brigade. I'm still trying to find time to get up to Nashville and dig in the archives of history and see if I can locate a little more detail on which Tennessee regiments were in that brigade. So I just have to tell you they were Tennesseans. We do know the 7th was in there, and Colonel William Jackson's there, Red Jackson. So that gives you a total of 3,500 troops. Now, in top secret, in late December, they're going to leave Grenada, Mississippi. They're going to take the old Braceport Road, and there's a stretch of it that's still extant. The Grenada Lake has covered up a great deal of it. But there is a stretch of the Graceport Road in the park there. They ride out that road about 1 o'clock in the morning in the sleet and rain on the 17th of December, 1862. Head up to Pontotoc, Mississippi, and turn north. They get up to Ripley, and then they turn, and on the 20th of December, they get to Holly Springs. Around 3 in the morning, and he sends some spies into Holly Springs to find out the exact location of the veterans. And any civilian that sees them, he puts them under house arrest because he doesn't want any compromise. He's slick on this. And these spies come back and they tell him, Yanks had a big Christmas party, boss. Guess what? They're asleep. So 5 a.m., they're going to hit. Van Dorn is going to be sighted on the way up on the 18th of December, just off of Pontotoc. We know this from Sylvanus Cadwallader, a war correspondent who was with Colonel Dickey's cavalry. He says, on the 18th, 3 miles northeast of Pontotoc, about 2 p.m., we could plainly see Van Dorn's men. But there's 3,500 of them. Dickey doesn't have that many. So he sends some men into Oxford to warn General Grant. These men get lost. And they don't show up until late in the afternoon of the 19th, around 4 o'clock in the afternoon, 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Let's see how it happens. Okay, there's the Brown House where the Lafayette County Jail is today. That Jackson Avenue used to be the Depot Street. The railroad depot is still right down there. Depot Street is now down here. Colonel Dickey is the man who has the cavalry that sees Van Dorn. The messengers finally show up with Sylvanus Cadwallader, Colonel Dickey. Cadwallader says, Dickey, myself, and four orderlies pressed to head to Oxford. We there about 4 o'clock in the afternoon of December the 19th. Grant walked out of the house to the telegraph office at the depot a quarter of a mile away. That tells me that Colonel Brown's house is about away. So, there's the depot. That's a rebuilt depot. Grant goes down, fires off the telegraph, goes north up to Holly Springs to warn now Colonel Robert C. Murphy, who's replaced Dubois. Junior Grant arrives. Late that afternoon, she writes in her diary, Colonel Dickey had come in from a scout only a half hour before my arrival and reported he had passed at a distance a column of troops said to be Van Dorn's. The general had been busy all evening telegraphing orders to be on the lookout and give Van Dorn a warm reception. So now we know absolutely she was in Oxford, Mississippi. She even saw Colonel Dickey coming in. More telegraphs go out. Let's go back up to Holly Springs. The railroad depot, that's the longevity. The depot building has been greatly modified after the war. It was burned during the war, greatly modified, but much of the walls of the building are the same. It's now a private residence, about a 20-room private residence. Never been in it. A very reclusive elderly lady lives there, and I've never been able to get in there and find anybody who can get me in there, but I'm still working on that one just to see what the place looks like. The message comes up. There's a close-up of the depot. Telegram arrives. Courier takes it down the street to Colonel Murphy. Colonel Murphy is in this house, the Hugh Craft house. Those are his headquarters. That's Robert C. Murphy. Goes to the telegraph office. He sends back to Grant. He says, I'm really not sure what you're talking about. And Grant finally says, tomorrow morning will be early enough for you to send your cavalry out to chase him. And so Grant conveniently forgets this. On the 20th, Grant writes, General Van Dorn appeared at Holly Springs, captured the garrison of 1,500 men and destroyed all of our munitions of war, food, and forage. Let's take a look here. The federal troops are scattered around town. At the north of town, where the Marshall County Fairgrounds used to be, is the 2nd Illinois Cavalry. To the east of town is the 101st Illinois Infantry, right there by the railroad depot. And in the town square is a smattering of troops from 29th to 62nd Illinois, the 20th Illinois, and the 26th Illinois, a total of about 1,500 men. Remember, this is just a garrison to guard a bunch of boxes of hardtack, unfortunately for the Confederates, some whiskey, which they get into, a whole bunch of sabers and pistols and ammunition, cheese and sugar and all kinds of stuff Confederate soldiers want. Van Dorn's men, when they left Grenada, it's the dead of winter now, it's late December, and most of them don't have coats until they've got two or three shirts on, and they're in the drizzle and the rain and almost freezing weather. So when they get in here, they're real quick to put on Yankee uniforms, wool uniforms. Here comes the Tennesseans, local town, Missourians, the Mississippians, and the center of town, Texans on the southern part of town. They know exactly where the Federals are, the spies have told them, and they move in off three columns. The Tennesseans move north to make sure any Federals up north don't come down and interfere with the other guys. These guys do the fighting, the Missourians and Mississippians hit the fairgrounds, the Federal cavalry there, run them off, capture a bunch of them. Here come the Texans. They capture the 101st Illinois. They move down the railroad depot into town, capture the troops in the town square, and then start blowing everything up. The depot street attack, I'll show you that simply because this is where Murphy said he was. There's the railroad depot again. Murphy claimed he was here in the railroad depot when the Confederates came into town. And he says that's where he was captured. They then moved down the street, which used to be called Depot Street. They now named it Van Dorn Avenue. And that'll take you into town, downtown area there. So let's take them into town. Murphy says, in attempting to escape by the rear of the depot building, in order to join my infantry forces, I was captured by a company of cavalry. My fate is most mortifying. I have wished 100 times today that I had been killed. That's the official account, because that's the only official document we have as to where Murphy was. I'll show you some other in just a moment. The Federals and the Confederates come into the town square, and there's a drawing of the Marshall County Courthouse, a modern courthouse. That's a modern, late 1800s. Looks very much like the old, though. And the town square hadn't changed a whole lot except for some asphalt. We move in, capture them there. And according to a private, John Milton Hubbard with the 7th Tennessee, they captured Colonel Murphy in bed, in his house. Now you believe which one you want. Remember there was a big party, a Christmas party, and the owner of the house, who I know, when he was restoring the inside of the house, he actually found some bullets in the hallway embedded in the wall. Which told me somebody did some shooting in that house for some reason or another, obviously. So something went on, we don't necessarily know exactly what, but the Confederates and a reporter from Mobile, Alabama claimed he was captured in bed. He claims in his official report he was captured in a railroad depot. So the supply base will be destroyed. It'll blow up all of the supplies in downtown Holly Springs. It'll blow the windows out of the brand new First Presbyterian Church. The concussion is so huge. There will be an armory north of town, which the Federals have converted into a hospital, an old Confederate Armory, and they will actually, they were, of course, the Federals would like to try to claim to you they blew up the hospital with all the patients in it. The hospital wasn't even being used yet. It had just gotten all the beds and supplies in there, and they, of course, did they let any doctors, anybody that was in there, they let them out, and then they destroyed the hospital. They spent all day doing that, and then at the end of the day, they skedaddled out of town. Grant writes, our loss here will probably amount to $400,000 of property and 1,500 men taken. Van Dorn writes, I surprised him at daylight that immense amount burned building trains took a great many arms and about 1,500 prisoners. I presume the value of the stores would amount to $1,500,000. So, whenever you hear two wide things like that, the truth is probably somewhere in the middle. Let's say it was 750,000 to a million. But in any case, that's a lot of supplies destroyed. And Grant's line of communication has now been severed. The line of communication he was bragging to Halleck about. Three trains have been captured and destroyed. And this puts Grant in a bad situation. Now, what is not often talked about is what happens at the same time a little further north. Grant was destroyed Hot Springs on 23 December. But Braxton Bragg has sent this man, Bedford Forrest. Forrest and Bragg are not getting along by now. It's to the stage of the game where Forrest is just about to kill Bragg. And I mean that literally. So Bragg sends Forrest out on a suicide mission. The idea is to cross the Tennessee River in the dead of winter with no bridges, no pontoons. He's cavalry, so he has to find some barges. But not only has he got to get across, he's got to get back, so they have to hide these barges so the Federals won't find them and destroy them, and they're able to do so. He head over to Lexington. At Lexington, Tennessee, on 18th of December, they run into some Federal forces commanded by the great agnostic, Colonel Robert Ingersoll. There's even an agnostic website today, has photographs of him on it, and talks about him being a great war hero during the Civil War. It's after the war he becomes an agnostic and makes speeches all around the nation and the world about agnosticism. But Ingersoll is captured. Along with Ingersoll, they captured two really nice 3-inch ordnance rifles. Now, these are the state-of-the-art cannon. They're made out of wrought iron, not cast iron. So this wrought iron is much stronger than cast iron. They're lighter weight, they're rifled, and they fire a 10 to 12 pound projectile with an accuracy of a 22 rifle. These are really effective guns. And they are taken by John Watson Morton, a brand new 20-year-old captain, lieutenant at this stage of the game. And these two guns will form the basis of Forrest's famous cavalry battalion that we'll hear of later on in the war. Morton's bullpups and all this. This is the nucleus of it right here. So this is a significant event because it will be these are the guns that are going to wreak havoc on the Federal forces at Braxton's Crossroads on the 10th of June, 1864. A funny side is, Ingersoll gets in a poker game with the Confederates some night. And they take all of his money to back up again. Oh, I had to search long and hard to find those gold 62 coins. But they took all of his money in a poker game. Which is a funny thing. He's actually playing poker with the captains, and they take it. So now that they take his guns, and Ingersoll signs a document promising not to fight anymore for the rest of the war, and ends his military career. He's gone. That's Ingersoll's war hero career. He's gone. Forrest moves on. He goes up to Jackson, Tennessee, and destroys the railroad track at Jackson against General Sullivan. He moves north, crosses the Obion River to Trenton, Tennessee. At Trenton, Tennessee, he captures a huge Federal supply depot and finds him a saber, a heavy dragoon saber that he took a liking to. He didn't let his men carry sabers because they're not effective. But he liked this thing, so he took it to a wheel and he sharpened it. A regulation cavalry saber is sharpened from the tip down 6 inches. He sharpens it from the tip to the hilt, top and bottom. It's a giant razor blade. And Forrest will end up killing over 30 men in hand-to-hand combat. Many of them will be dispatched with a saber. At least one at Overlone will be decapitated with it. When Forrest charges with that saber, you almost always found him alone. His men would pull back. I thought about this and I realized that if my boss was 6'3 and was strong as that and swinging a razor like that, I'd give him plenty of room too. It then moves up to Union City, crosses the Obion, that's the painting I showed you earlier, destroys the bridges there across the river, and then the railroad tracks up at Union City, and then he skedaddles back to get across the Tennessee River against Kitchen, and gets into a battle at Parker's Crossroads on the 31st of December. It's at Parker's Crossroads that he thinks he's got the battle won, and the Federals manage to get around in the rear of him. One of the staff officers comes up to him and says, "General, I got some bad news. We got an enemy in the front and an enemy in the rear of us." And he says, "That's excellent. We can now attack in two directions." So look at what's happened to Grant's supply line. We always talk about Holly Springs, but look at what's happened between Columbus and Grand Junction. He's got no line of communication. It's absolutely gone. And this was just fortuitous that all of this happened at precisely the same time, because I can assure you Bragg and Pemberton are not necessarily working in conjunction with one another. Bragg and Bragg didn't work in conjunction with anybody. So, Grant writes, "I determined to abandon my campaign in the interior. Pemberton was falling back at the same time." Let's take a look at what he's talking about. Grant has to fall back. He has no line of communication. So there's Holly Springs is gone. He falls back to Holly Springs and sets up his headquarters there. And he and Judy take up residence at another house, which is up for sale now for, I think, $7 million. Yeah. Pemberton uses the railroads and shifts troops south over to Vicksburg. Because remember, Sherman is coming down the river. I love the way Grant says this. Pemberton got back to Vicksburg before Sherman got there. Pretty succinct. Let's see how it works. Sherman leaves on Memphis on the 20th of December. Gets to Chickasaw Bayou on the 26th of December. He claims that he did not know that Grant pulled back. In his memoirs, he says, "I had no idea that Grant pulled back." Remember, the game plan is Grant's going to keep Pemberton occupied here, and then he's going to defeat him and move down and join Sherman down here, but Grant's now way up here and not coming. Sherman says, "I didn't know that." Well, that's not exactly the whole story. Late on the 20th of December, remember the cavalry raid in Holly Springs happened at 5 in the morning. Some of those cavalrymen, about 40 of them at the fairgrounds, at the Marshall County Fairgrounds, escaped. They rode hell for leather to Memphis, and they warned the tail end of Sherman's column, leaving Memphis. Remember, all those boats don't leave simultaneously. They warned the tail end of the column what's happened. And Sherman learns the next day that Grant has suffered a huge defeat at Holly Springs. But he didn't have any orders to the contrary, so he moves on south and attacks anyway. He conveniently forgets that in his memoirs. So let's take a look at Chickasaw Bayou. 26 to 29 December, Confederates, I have three brigades up there, and here come the Federals of Sherman's 30,000 men coming down the Yazoo River, going upriver, and then here come the Federates into Vicksburg by train, coming south from Grenada, and moving up, and we bring in three more brigades. So we got six brigades now. Commanded by the first president of Mississippi State University, Brigadier General Stephen D. Lee. Sherman will attack in two columns primarily, be defeated. He will lose a patriotic number of 1,776 men on the 29th of December 1862. Grant writes, "His efforts to capture the city were necessarily unabated." This is a drawing of the Missourians attacking across Chickasaw Bayou. This is Chickasaw Bayou today. The actual action that was portrayed is just a little bit to the right of this. This is a modern road that calls way across the Chickasaw Bayou, which has been diverted and dried up now. So that area is, except in the wintertime when it fills with water, it's pretty dry. This time of year, it's probably pretty dry. It's been down there quite a while. In about 6 months, but I'm sure it's pretty dry down there right now. Because I was standing in the middle of Grant's Canal today and don't have any mud on my boots, so I'm sure it's dry and cheap somebody. Sherman writes this magnificent letter to Grant. "I cannot undertake to describe with what painful suspense we listened for the sound of your guns in the distance while we lay in the swamps of the Yazoo." That is a, you owe me big for this one, buddy. You owe me for this. Sherman is going to be filleted in the press for this attack because the press doesn't know the whole story. All they know is Sherman went down the river and got wrecked. A reporter from the New York Tribune is going to write an article that's going to just rip him wide open and renew the accusations that he's crazy. Actually use the term crazy quite a bit. The excerpts of that newspaper report are in the official records, but Sherman made sure the part about being crazy was cut out. You've got to go back to the actual newspaper report, and he actually uses the term Knoxo that Sherman was crazy. Sherman would court-martial this man. Court-martial a civilian reporter and charge him with being a spy. He's that mad about this thing. He actually wants him hanged. Doesn't happen, but he's pretty ticked off about the whole situation. So, Sherman is withdrawn, he falls back to the Yazoo River, and he plans to renew the attack on the 1st of January, but a fog bank moves in. It's so foggy they can't see anything, and Admiral Porter tells him, you know, we need to get out of here. So they head down the Yazoo River, and they go over to Milliken's Bend, arriving here on the 2nd of January, and guess who shows up on the 2nd of January? Remember McClernand? Well, wasn't able to get to Memphis until the 28th of December. He had only with his wedding party, well, he's gotten married. He married his stepsister. He married his sister-in-law. His first wife had died, so he married her baby sister. He's in his late 40s, she's 25, not a bad deal. But he gets held up. He's got Governor Richard Yates with him, and the whole wedding party is coming down. He wants to have Governor Yates see him take command of this army at Memphis. The train hits a cow, derails in Illinois. They finally get a steamboat. They show up in Memphis on the 20th of December, and they expect to find this army on the wharf of Memphis with all the flags waving, and McClernand's going to get off in front of his new 25-year-old bride and take command, and there's nothing there but papers blowing across because everybody's gone. They tell me that on a cold, dark night, if you stand on a wharf, you can still hear the cursing. There's a cloud of purple vapor floating over the river of McClernand and the profanity. But he shows up and he assumes command on the 4th of January and names this army the Army of the Mississippi. This is his independent command. And he forms three corps to make Sherman furious. Here's a man Sherman does not like at all, George Morgan. He gives him the 13th Corps and gives Sherman the 15th Corps. Sherman doesn't like McClernand, he doesn't like Morgan, but he has no choice, so he has to become a corps commander. This is how the Army ends up in the swamps of Louisiana. In the winter months, they have gone down to Chickasaw Bayou and they've fallen back. Take a quick look here. Grant is up in Memphis, Tennessee with Judy. They're actually in Holly Springs, and on the 10th of January, they're going to move to Memphis, Tennessee. Take the train. They go to Memphis. They set up a house in the Gayosa House. There's a mansion in Memphis called the Huntfella Mansion. And they will tell you that Grant, that was where Grant's headquarters was, and that's where he planned the Vicksburg campaign. That's their selling point. You know, if you got a big B&B restaurant, you got to have a selling point. I cannot find any documentation anywhere that he ever set foot in the house, but it's just as logical as anything that he had his headquarters there. But I can assure you he didn't plan the Vicksburg campaign in the house. Because he's winging this thing, as we're going to see. But Junior's in the Gales house. Grant writes, General McClernand invites the house. General McClernand has followed back to the White River, gone on a wild goose chase to the post of Arkansas. McClernand wants a victory as his new army commander, so he decides what he's going to do is get him a victory. And Grant later writes, 5,000 Confederate troops left in the rear might have caused as much trouble and loss while navigating the Mississippi. Remember, this is in his memoirs written in 1885. This is what he wrote at the time. McClernand has gone on a wild goose chase. He's very unhappy with McClernand going north when Vicksburg is south. But later on, as we're going to see, McClernand's going to capture the coast of Arkansas. So, 20/20 hindsight, it was a good idea. So he says these 5,000 troops might have caused trouble. It was a good idea. Let's take a quick look at Arkansas Post. It's up here. right up here on the White River, just on the White, the Arkansas River, and you can see where Little Rock is right up, and Arkansas Post is right here. Sherman McClernand and Admiral Porter are going to move up. They'll hit Arkansas Post and capture. Quick look. Arkansas Post is gone. The fortification is now under a lake as they dammed up the river. So there's really, you can go to Arkansas Post. It's an interesting place. It's one of those places that, like Iuka, you got to go to Dallas or Memphis to get there. It's just no easy way to go to Arkansas Post, but you can go to Dumas, Arkansas, and cut them over. But don't be disappointed when you find out that the fortification is under a lake. Well, Arkansas Post falls, and now, Grant says, I received passages from both Sherman and Porter urging me to come down and take command in person. They don't like working for McClernand, and Grant has gotten permission from Washington. They said, there's a clause here that McClernand is only the commander independently if you're not there. If you are there, you're senior to him, so of course you command. So, and Sherman and McClernand are saying, Sherman and Porter are saying, get down here, and you be the senior man. We don't want to work for this guy. Remember, Sherman is a West Pointer, and he doesn't like working for this political general. Porter doesn't like West Pointers, but he likes politicians even less. So he's ready to accept Grant. Anyone want to decipher that for me?
Break it out.
Let's take a quick break.